Welcome, everyone. I wasn't sure I was going to do this right away, but I decided I'm going to. Welcome to Knights of the Old Republic 2, the Sith Lords. Making my little Discord announcement. Alright. Let me just plug my phone in while I've got my stream manager set up here. So, Knights of the Old Republic 2, the Sith Lords. As you can see, I have installed the latest version of the Sith Lords Restored Content Modification. Volume 1.8.6. This modification is designed to restore and enhance a lot of cut content to the game. I've also got some mods installed that help actually make a lot of the game's more rare drops drop a little bit more frequently so you can actually see them. A lot of the items that dropped on my first playthrough of this game when I did this are things that I never encountered, and I played through this game over a dozen times on console. There's a couple of mods that I could have gotten, like Coruscant, going to Coruscant and seeing the Jedi Temple there. I elected not to, largely because I just don't feel like going to Coruscant is going to be a good idea, because it has a bad tendency to make the modifications around HK-47... and the restored content mod not work right. So this is not the standard game as it was released. There was originally meant to be an HK-47 factory mission installed, but the developers ran out of time. Obsidian didn't have the time to push this game out with it intact, but a lot of the data files were there, so somebody basically took it out and restored it and added enough stuff into it to make it actually work, doing their best to try and make it actually gel appropriately with the original intent of the game. So what you guys are going to see is somebody's attempt at making this game go as close to how it was supposed to be at release. So you're going to see some extra things in here. You're going to see a few extra stuffs. I don't own the content to any of this, so I don't intend to infringe upon anybody, let alone the mod makers. Actually, I'm extremely grateful for them. If I get the opportunity, or if I can actually remember to do it during or in between one of my streams, I'll give a shout out to the person who actually made this restored content mod, because after my one playthrough doing it, this is easily one of my favorite mods of any video game ever. So, once again, we're given three templates to work from for male and female characters, but you'll notice that this time we don't choose scout, soldier, or scoundrel. Instead, we choose Jedi Consular, Jedi Sentinel, or Jedi Guardian. So, and the game gives you a light idea of how each one of these is going to work. Jedi Guardians focus on combat training and lightsaber mastery. So what that means is that we will gain force powers over the course of the game as we level up, but we will not gain that many force powers as we level up throughout the game. The Guardian actually gains the fewest and is the most combat dependent, so I believe they gain a few additional feats and have some additional melee focus. And we are going to immediately ban somebody because the very first person to show up was here for less than a second and was clearly a bot. So Jedi Guardians are what you pick if you don't want to rely very heavily on force powers. You'll still get plenty of them, but you won't get nearly as many as you will the other two subclasses. Jedi Sentinels. Jedi Sentinels are a mix and mesh of wielding the power of the Force and wielding martial prowess. So they'll have better blaster and combat training and than a consular, but they will have weaker, or they will also have but the consular has more Force powers, and the Guardian has better physical adaptability and martial prowess, but a Sentinel will have better Force capabilities. So the Sentinel is the middle of the road. This is what you take if you don't want to follow a super focus of either physical combat or over-reliance on Force powers. The Jedi Consular, they gain the largest amount of Force powers and Force points for mana, and easily become one of the most overpowered classes in the game if you know what you're doing. By the end of the game, I was able to throw around Force Lightning with a light side consular and pretty much never run out of Force power. The downside to these units is that they gain the least amount of HP and physical adaptability and combat prowess of any class. However, their Force powers, they gain more of them every level than any other class. Sometimes they can even gain two Force powers in a single level. It actually got to the point with both of my consular runs that I did that I was actually running out of powers that were light side only to take. So I actually had to start taking dark powers just, or even other random universal powers, just because I actually didn't have enough other powers to draw on. And their Force point meter usually gets so gigantic that they can very readily and very easily spam Force abilities and just completely fuck over an entire fight purely from that. I think I'm gonna run a male Jedi Sentinel. Canonically speaking, the character who is the protagonist of Knights of the Old Republic 2 is actually a female by the name of Mitra Surik. And she was, in the expanded universe, essentially one of Revan's top lieutenants and generals during the Mandalorian Wars. That's the only thing I'm going to tell you about this character, because I don't want to spoil everything else about them that we're going to learn over the course of the game. If you are new to Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic 2 and you have not played Knights of the Old Republic 1, I highly recommend taking a Guardian or a Sentinel first. Do not take a Consular, because Consulars, they suck when they don't rely heavily on Force powers, and they need to use a lot of their Force powers very effectively in order to have a full grasp of combat. If they aren't using their Force powers to turn the tide, you are using this class wrong. It is built to be that way. And there's a reason why even the game itself says recommended for advanced players only. It's not trying to insult you, and it's not trying to challenge you. It's trying to warn you. This class will gain very little health compared to any other class when leveling up. This class is not going to get as many feats when it comes to physical adaptability. This class is going to have a heavy, heavy focus on gaining lots of Force powers and needing to use them. The Sentinel is going to allow you to have a lovely balance, and your myriad different types of traits, tricks, skills, and abilities are going to make you a nightmare for your opponents to deal with. The thing about Sentinels that can make them a little tricky is that their lack of focus means that in certain situations where a specialist might be helpful, such as somebody who has an overfocus in physical combat or an overfocus in Force powers, can actually make them struggle. And they will have a problem getting off the ground in most playthroughs early game, purely due to the fact that you are going to be struggling because you won't really know what the hell you're doing yet. The Jedi Guardian is probably the easiest class in the game to use for anybody who is a beginner to the Knights of the Old Republic series, and in particular to Knights of the Old Republic 2, because things work a little bit differently in this game than in Knights of the Old Republic 1. And in my opinion, pretty much every one of those changes is for the better. For my particular preference and playthrough, we're going to be taking a Sentinel. And we're going to be customizing virtually everything about this character that the game is going to let us, which is not much. Okay. So there's various attributes. We had all of these attributes in Star Wars Knights of the Old Republic 1, but they work a teeny bit differently in this game. So first is strength. Strength measures your physical power. High strength adds modifiers to melee damage and chance to hit, which is extremely important for characters that rely on close combat weapons such as vibroblades and lightsabers. That's true, mostly. One thing that this game does not tell you about that is that any character with high dexterity or high strength can wield a lightsaber if they gain sensitivity to the Force. Lightsabers are finesse weapons in this game, which is a trait from old school D&D that any D&D player will recognize. And effectively what finesse means is it will actually take buffs off of your dexterity modifier or your strength modifier, depending on how you use it. I am not actually going to put any points in strength because I want to show off blasters from for a good point of the game until I can actually unlock the ability to build a lightsaber. So we're going to stick with dexterity-focused equipment for the first part of the game. Next is dexterity. This measures agility and reflexes. High dexterity adds modifiers to ranged attack rolls, such as blasters, and will increase your defense stat, which makes you harder to hit. If you've ever played Dungeons & Dragons, effectively what defense is it is your armor class. The enemy has to be able to roll a number higher than your defense stat in order to strike you. If they can't, their attack will miss. That's just a sad fact of their life, right? Next, it also adds modifiers to attacks involving ranged attacks, such as blasters. So any character with high dexterity is going to want to use blasters predominantly. So ranged weapons. Come here, bubby. Come on. There we go. My cat wanted to hop up. I apologize, everybody. So the next stat we're going to look at is going to be our constitution. Constitution represents your health and resiliency. High constitution adds modifiers to vitality points gained at each level. Constitution also determines what types of implants you can equip. This is important for every class. That is entirely true. So this affects the amount of HP you gain per level. It affects how well you resist physical attacks and physical abilities that will stun or knock you down. In fact, constitution saving throws are a thing in this game. So you want a moderate to high constitution in every playthrough. Intelligence. Intelligence represents knowledge and reasoning. High intelligence adds modifiers to a number of points a character has to spend on essential skills. So the way intelligence works in this game is it does not work like traditional D&D. It does affect your knowledge and reasoning. That's where it actually makes sense. Here's where it doesn't. You will end up spending a number of skill points. Come back here, baby. You can jump up here. Come on. You can spend a number of skill points on special skills, which range from anything from hacking computers to blowing shit up. And you will probably want to do this a fair bit because you will need the modifier bonuses. But the point of doing this is characters that have low intelligence, there's pretty much only two skills they can invest in: treat injury and awareness. And that's because they won't have skill points for literally anything else. Next is wisdom. This represents your willpower and your perception. High wisdom adds modifiers to save to basically your will saving throws. It also allows you to modify your force points and force power saving throws. Force powers of a Jedi with high wisdom are much harder to resist. So any force power that's going to force your opponent to make a saving throw when you use it, this is the stat that needs to be high, or you won't get anything out of it. Charisma. High charisma increases the potency of many a character's force powers. It also reduces the penalty of using them with an opposing alignment. Light side characters with high charisma can use dark side powers with a weaker penalty. High charisma also improves your companion's chance to hit. Finally, it influences a character's persuade skill. You need a high charisma in order to use persuasion. Persuasion is very fun in this game. It's also very funny. So, I put decent stats into virtually everything except for strength, because we are going to start out as a sentinel. Sentinels are jacks of all trades. This is actually a little bit better than you think it is. Okay. I don't know why my repairer is garbage. Yeah, see, I have to spend 2 points to up repair for some unholy reason. So, we're going to go ahead and talk about all of these skills here, because all of these are important, and some of them work a tiny bit differently than they used to. Most of them work pretty much the same. Computer use allows you to slice computer programs using disposable logic ramps called computer spikes. You might disable gun turrets, flood patrol areas, or more complicated tasks requiring spikes such as hacking droids and altering their programming. A high rank in this skill increases the number of reduces the number of spikes required by 1 to a minimum of 1 for every 4 points total, including attribute score modifiers. So the more your computer use skill is, the fewer spikes you will have to spend when you need to do something dangerous or interesting. Demolitions. Demolitions can be used to set, recover, or disarm mines, such devices in difficulty range in difficulty from minor to devastating. DC 10 to set, DC 30 to set. Attempting to disarm the mine adds +5 to the DC. Attempting to recover it adds +10. This skill cannot be used untrained. So, the thing about demolitions is it adds modifiers to allow you to disarm explosives, but it also affects how much damage, if I'm recalling correctly, that grenades and such will do when you use them. This is very important because a lot of areas have mines and various bombs in them, and you need a character with high demolitions in order to deal with those. Stealth. Stealth governs the use of camouflage devices to enter stealth mode. If a character equips such a device and activates it, and activates stealth mode, opponents must make awareness checks versus your stealth skill or be unable to detect them. Even if the character's in a direct line of sight, a character in stealth mode can set, disable, and recover mines. Party members will not automatically enter combat while in this mode. Combat will also cancel stealth mode. Stealth mode will not work without a camouflage unit. Units of higher quality grant a bonus to the skill. The skill cannot be used untrained. Stealth basically allows you to perform the sneaky sneak. If you want to be a sneaky assassin, you need this skill. I don't use it, and I don't use it for a reason. It's called Stealth is completely unnecessary in this game, just as it was completely unnecessary in the previous title. I have never needed to use this in order to be able to continue through the game. Awareness. Awareness governs your ability to spot objects or enemies hidden by stealth. If a successful check of this skill is made against a stealth skill of an enemy or the DC of a mine, the enemy or object is noticed and becomes visible. Awareness is always active, but results are best without a character or while a character is moving slowly. Running imparts a -5 penalty to any of the checks of the skill. Awareness allows you to see mines that have been placed and enemies that have been stealthed. It does not allow you to do much else. You need at least one character in your party with a high awareness stat. If you choose this to be the main character, you could pump all your points somewhere else and it isn't gonna matter. Persuasion. Persuasion is an extremely useful skill that only the main character can level up. It allows these persuade options that appear in dialogue with interesting or sensitive information as available a character might otherwise be reluctant to reveal. When selected, rank in this skill is compared with how extreme the request is. Difficulty classes such as low, medium, or high, relative to your player level. A guard might easily agree to increase a bounty, but convincing him to leave his post would be much harder. Persuasion is amazing because persuasion allows you to do so many hilarious and stupid things. It allows you to screw... Excuse me. It allows you to screw with a lot of people and characters by messing with their heads and trying to persuade them either not to fight you. You can intimidate them into giving you information. You can also intimidate them into giving you better rewards. Damn hiccups, I'm trying to do something here. So, there's a lot of reasons... Excuse me. There's a lot of reasons to want to use persuasion. And it's only something the main character can use. Repair. Repair is a skill that allows characters to fix disabled mechanical devices such as droids using disposable packages of parts. Number of parts kits as required increases with the difficulty of repair. This skill reduces the number of parts needed by one to a minimum of one for every 4 points total, including attribute score modifiers. This skill also modifies the amount of vitality points recovered when the party member droids use repair kits, advanced repair kits, and construction kits on themselves to repair combat damage. So, repair for mechanical units is treat injury to biologicals. In the sense that the higher a robot's repair stat, or droid's repair stat, the better it repairs itself with a repair kit. Or its upgraded variants, the advanced repair kit and the construction kit. Now, the other thing about it is, repair is mandatory for certain interactions with a certain droid that we have and exploring its story. Security. Security is used to access electronic locking devices. Once a character invests points in this skill, it becomes one of the default options on targeted doors and containers. Security spikes can grant bonuses to this skill, and any in inventory will also appear as a default option on targeted doors and containers. Characters with no points invested cannot attempt to use this skill. Security is basically your ability to open locks on doors, chests, and anything that has a particular kind of electronic lock. You will need somebody with high security, or you will have to try and cut your way through the door or cut open the object. Or bash it open. Treat injury. Treat injury improves the amount of damage healed with a med pack used, or adding the modified rank to the number of points healed. Advanced med packs and life support packs apply multipliers to your skill to increase the amount healed again. Treat injury is basically, I heal myself better. Most characters will want at least a few points invested in this. Alright, we've gained the following feats. Light armor proficiency. Guess what? We're never wearing armor in this game except for a particular pair of armor sets. Critical strike, flurry, power attack, power blast, rapid shot, sniper shot, weapon proficiency, and focus. Weapon proficiency is in blaster pistols and rifles, weapon proficiency in lightsabers, weapon proficiency in melee weapons, Jedi defense, force immunity fear, Jedi sense, and war veteran. So, we can use an inner calm that can't be shaken by mere threats to mind or body. This grants an understanding, which is a shield that fear cannot breach. This feat is always active. What this basically means is enemies cannot scare you through intimidation. It doesn't work that way. next is Jedi Sense. It allows you to better sense incoming attacks. A feat is always active and grants defense bonuses dependent upon the Jedi's consular, sentinel, or guardian level. Bonuses start at +2 at level 1 and increase by +2 for every subsequent 6 levels in one of these classes, for levels 7, 13, 19, etc. May as well use the name we used in our last playthrough. Please enjoy the cinematic. Star Wars, Knights of the Old Republic 2, the Sith Lords. It is a perilous time for the galaxy. A brutal civil war has all but destroyed the Jedi Order, leaving the ailing Republic on the verge of collapse. Amid the turmoil, the evil Sith have spread across the galaxy, hunting down and destroying the remaining Jedi Knights. Narrowly escaping a deadly Sith ambush, the last known Jedi clings to life aboard a battered freighter near the ravaged world of Peragus. This prologue is basically a big fat tutorial. I am going to be doing it. purely just to show you guys everything that happens in the prologue.
Sometimes bashing or blowing open a container. Some doors can be bashed open or cut open with a lightsaber or cutting tool. Some doors require the use of the security skill to open. Use your security skill from the action bar to open this door. This old woman appears to be dead. There is a key card on the body that looks like it opens a locker somewhere. You can hear a banging noise coming from the other side of the door to this storage compartment. But the door, this blast door, is magnetically sealed and cannot be opened. If you need, this lift will take you to the outer hull of the Ebon Hawk, where you will find many parts and lines to use for accessing and repairing the hyperdrive. Use the lift controls to go up. There is a hull. This is the engine room. This is the cargo hold. Talking to other characters is much like using the computer console in the cockpit. Scroll through your response options or move the mouse cursor, and then click to select a response. Note that some responses may influence how other characters react to you, so choose carefully. Furthermore, certain skills, powers, and attributes may modify what choices you have, or how successful you are with those choices. 3CFD is malfunctioning. You can fix him by using a part. Luckily, you have already found one. If you repair 3CFD, he can join your party and assist you in repairing the ship. Success! You have fixed 3CFD. Now he will join your party.
Excuse me.
3CFD is now a member of your party. To change which party member you control, click on the portrait or press tab. Later, when you have more companions... Sensor droids emerged from this box when you opened it. These droids will make for excellent target practice. Use the weapon from this container to attack the droids. You can equip a...
Use a security tunnel and you can get through anyway. I'm sorry I'm interrupting her, but she's kind of annoying after a minute. Ugh. Mines!
misses the port sign. The bubbles ahead indicate mines that you've detected automatically with your awareness skill. Some mines require higher awareness to detect. Approach mines carefully. They will blow up and damage you if you get too close. You can use your demolition skill to either disable or recover these mines. Recovering mines requires a higher demolition skill than disabling them, but you get to keep the mine, which you can then use to set as a trap for enemies or break down into components at a workbench. You can use the explosive device in this missile to blow open the engine room door inside the Ebon Hawk. This will give you access to the hyperdrive. After you plant a mine, back away quickly so that you do not take damage. This is the starboard side of the Ebon Hawk. This open hatch has some parts that will be useful for getting main power restored. This busted engine port has some needed parts for the Ebon Hawk's hyperdrive. Take the parts here back down below to get main power restored. You can use...
So I want to show off one more thing before we actually open the engine room.
Of the human lying on the bed. The med pack can stabilize. Success! You are stabilized. To recover fully, you will require the medical facilities at the Peragus mining station, but you are not in any danger of dying from your wounds right now.
This tutorial is very hand-holdy. I would argue that the tutorial for Knights of the Old Republic 1 is actually less grating.
You can now plot a course to the Peragus mining
station. Just going to shut her up because she's telling you something you've already been told 3 times. Babe, I need to get you what you need in order to bake another loaf of bread. Yeah, for some reason I'm craving some freshly baked bread all of a sudden, and I don't know why.
The sensors show the door to the storage compartment is being sliced. There is someone, or something, else alive on the Ebon Hawk.
I can work with that. That looks suspiciously like somebody from the game we just played. But he looks like he's a lot less red and rusty. That didn't sound right. Hey, look, we're in a Colto tank.
Awake.
What's going on? Where the hell am I? Where's my ship? It's being a passenger on the Republic capital ship, the Harbinger. Immersion in the Colto tanks can heal most wounds. If you have lost vitality points during your explorations, return to the medical bay here and use the empty Colto tank behind you to heal your wounds. So that's the game telling you there is a free heal here if you need it.
Examining the survivors of the damaged freighter.
Medical.
Looks like it goes by the name of the Ebon Hawk. Only one survivor, placed in the Colto tank for recovery. The carbon scoring on the vessel suggests it was in a battle, but no indication of who fired on it. Couldn't get much from the Nava computer. I'm surprised the ship was able to make it inside the Peragus asteroid field without the asteroid drift charts. Aside from the lone survivor, we recovered an old woman. No life signs. There was also a protocol droid and a utility droid on board. Sent both down to maintenance while security sorts through the other items on the ship. It looks like the utility droid, a T3 unit, was able to get the ship working enough to get to the colony. We're prepared to...
Huh. The Ebon Hawk. What?
Could be a Jedi. But we won't know for sure until we get the transmission back from the Republic. If the survivor is a Jedi, that would account for the recovery rate. But I'm more concerned that a Jedi here may cause trouble. Some of the miners, especially Korta, are already another accident today. A detonation in the ventilation tunnels. If the lockdown measures hadn't activated, the whole facility would have been destroyed. Got most of the injured to the Colto tanks in time, but the rest had to go to the morgue. One of the wounded said a droid caused the accident, but we couldn't get any specifics.
Accidents involving droids and explosives? What the hell?
Miners about the Jedi. A number of the droids have been acting oddly. And not even memory wipes seem to be fixing the problem. There was a detonation in another one of the fuel vents the droids were working in. We deactivated several of them and moved them down to maintenance. But we're still treating the plasma burns. That cuts us down to almost half shifts, and with the droids malfunctioning, we may not make the Tilo shipment for this month. Fortunately, the detonation didn't cause a lockdown.
Warning! There has been a fuel detonation in the mining tunnels. Emergency lockdown commencing. All personnel report to quarters. And prepare for emergency venting countermeasures.
No! If the ventilation systems are malfunctioning, evacuate the medical bay! Everyone evacuate!
What? Patients 1, 2, 4, and 5 were deceased. Patient 3 recovered. Me? All subjects are being treated for severe plasma burns. Last treatment request resulted in death for all subjects except patient 3, who was reduced to minimal life signs. A lethal dose of sedatives was administered to all the tanks, including 3, but there's no record of whoever managed to order the treatment. Storage room and the door to the morgue. That camera was centered exclusively on me. Hello, Exile. First time what? If you're asking playing this game, no, I'm a veteran of this game. Yeah. This is actually one of my favorite Star Wars games. I would argue this is probably the best Star Wars game that's been made.
Find what you're looking for amongst the dead.
Your voice. I heard it as I floated in the cult hotel.
Yes, I had hoped as much. I slept here too long and could not awaken. It may be I reached out unconsciously.
I disagree. I think this game, even without the restoration content mod, which I do have, is actually still better than KOTOR 1. Particularly from a gameplay perspective, the tweaks that were made, I think, were pretty much all for the better. Slept too long. You look dead when
close
I came
close to
in.
Death. Yes, closer than I'd like. You have the smell of the Colto tank about you. How do you feel?
The Colto tank left me a little drained. Who are you?
I am Kreia, and I am your rescuer, as you are mine. Tell me, do you recall what happened?
Oh, yeah, I did. I always wondered what the hell was ever going to happen with the HK thing. Because it felt like there was something that was supposed to happen in all my playthroughs when I was a kid, but it never happened. And it wasn't until years later I discovered there's a reason for that. It's called they wanted to put it in there, but Obsidian had to rush the game out, so they didn't get a chance. And I was like, fuck! That's not fun. Last thing I remember, I was on board a Republic ship. The Harbinger. What happened to it?
Your ship was attacked. You were the only survivor. A result of your Jedi training, no doubt.
I think you can go back to Telos if you get the fuel from Nar Shaddaa, and then immediately go back to Telos right afterwards. But I think Nar Shaddaa has to be one of the first planets you visit when you do that. I'm no longer a member of the Order.
Your stance, your walk, tells me you are a Jedi. Your walk is heavy. You carry something that weighs you down.
It doesn't really matter, though, because when you alert them of the... Like, when you talk to the Hutts about the new fuel source... It's pretty self-explanatory after that, that the Hutts go and talk to them.
The Jedi Order and I have a troubled history.
So it would seem. Keep your past and let us focus on the now.
All right. What's going on? How did we get here?
I do not know. I was removed from the events of the world as I slept. A survey of the surroundings may provide the answers we seek.
The ship we arrived in, the Ebon Hawk... must still be in this place. We should recover it and leave.
I do admit, the restored content mod, though, it makes this game so much better. And this is already an amazing game. KOTORs 1 and 2 are fantastic titles. Why do we need to leave?
We were attacked once, and I fear our attackers will not give up the hunt so easily. Without transport, weapons, and information, they will find us easy prey indeed.
You sure there's nothing else you can tell me about this place?
Even as I slept, I felt much unrest here. I saw strange visions, minds colored with fear. Now, everything here feels terribly silent. A last word of caution. I would find out as much as you can about this place quickly. I fear we will need to depart as suddenly as we arrived.
All right. We'll see. There's got to be someone left alive.
You may wish to extend
here.
Your search to some clothes. If only for proper first impressions.
Patients in the medbay were killed by a lethal dose of sedatives. Any idea how it happened?
I do not know. Why did they spare you?
They didn't. I got the same dose, but survived.
Indeed, a Jedi trance could protect one from such poisons. In fact, the sedatives may have been intended to keep you unconscious for some time. It would prove lethal to those untrained in such techniques, however. Most curious.
You seem to know a lot about Jedi techniques.
Perhaps we could discuss it at length later on. Now we have other concerns, among them finding our new enemy.
I'll make sure to return soon to make sure.
I leave
you're
all you right. to the explorations of this place. Here I will remain and attempt to center myself.
Our very first weapon. You've taken your first steps on the path to the light. The light and dark side system makes a return in this game that was in the previous title. We need the plasma torch in order to be able to bash the door open. The game is teaching us that we can bash doors open. Vibro cutter. So, vibro cutters are basically a short vibro sword. It's light, it's easy to use. Oh, look, some droid impact armor. That's interesting. Hi! We'll just use basic attacks for now. I'll get into all the other attacks later. Each one of them has a pro and a con. Mining laser. Now I can equip a blaster, which is the intention of this, to use some blasters first. Master Flurry or Bust. You can argue for several different melee attacks. I used to emphasize critical strikes, actually. So what a blaster does is blasters have regular attack, they have power blast, rapid shot, and sniper shot. For anybody who comes in that doesn't know, power blast is basically a focused shot. Rapid shot is basically a repeating attack at reduced accuracy, and snipe shot has increased critical hit chance. Pretty much all of these have an accuracy debuff. I'll be going light side for this playthrough. Although I have actually seen what happens in every playthrough, more or less, when you do that. It was only recently that I learned you can actually unlock force sensitivity in virtually all of your companions. And you will want to do that. I'm glad I'm getting equipment for droids, but I don't have a droid to equip anything on right now. Security tunneler. Good God, that aim, bro! Holy shit. Oh my God, I've never seen anybody fail to hit a damn door before that many times. I didn't even know you could. Wow. Oh my God, he did it again. And again. At this point, I just want to see if he'll ever actually break the frickin' door up. Oh my God. Talk about bad aim. Tactical side slash against a locker. Oh my God, he finally did it, ladies and gentlemen.
Is this thing on? All right, all hands, especially you, Corner. Listen up, because I'm not going to say this again. The next one of you Juma heads to try and smuggle a blaster, or so help me, any sort of military-grade frag weapons into my facility is gonna take a long walk out the airlock. Why? Because in case you forgot, Peragian fuel explodes at high temperatures. That's what blasted that chunk out of Peragus 2 and created this asteroid field. So if I catch any of you with anything other than sonic charges or mining lasers, I'll burn you and your contract. Security out.
Huh. Damn.
Why the hell were people trying so hard to smuggle military-grade weapons onto a mining station?
And according to one of the miners, it was because one of the sonic charges went off prematurely. And like before, it was one set by a mining droid. The three idiots were grouped so close to the charge, it might as well have been a grenade going off. The blast turned their bones to dust. The blast wrecked the internal components of the droid that set the charge, though, so we can't even dissect it to see what happened. I don't like what's going on here. Ever since that Jedi showed up, things are getting worse. It's not just Korda and his miners, or the fights, but now the droids are acting crazy. If we don't find what's causing this, or who, this facility's gonna be space dust by the time the next Telos freighter arrives.
Sounds like ever since I got on here, somebody was trying to sabotage this station. Could have even been this Korda I'm seeing.
So, you're in maintenance. Then maybe you can tell me what's going on with these droids.
Sir, I don't know. It's like their behavior cores are undergoing binary decay, but I can't find the source. This shouldn't be happening.
Well, that's reassuring. It isn't happening. So the next time we nearly have a breach in the ventilation tunnels, I could just close my eyes and pretend it's my imagination. You better give me some answers. I want to know the damage these droids can do if they start mining us instead of asteroid rock.
Sir, these droids aren't combat models. Their mining lasers are weaker and less accurate than blasters. I doubt those droids could even hit one of us.
Are you blind? What about the miners in Medbay? It's sabotage, and it started right after the commander said we weren't going to sell the Jedi to the Exchange. So I want you to find out how these droids are being sabotaged. That'll tell me who's trying to clear a path to get that Jedi off the facility and stop him. In the meantime, make sure the security's armed with all the ion and sonic charges you can find. If those droids start coming after me, I'm gonna need more than low-grade mining lasers to take them down. Clear?
Yes, sir. Maintenance control out.
Idiot.
Sounds like he's trying to figure out what the hell's going on.
I installed an override switch to shut down any droids on this level, just in case someone locks me out of the administration console. As added insurance, I tied the override switch into the circuit to the holding cell door. It'll make sure it can only be opened if all droids in the level are shut down. I doubt Korda or any of his men have the skill to pull off something like this, but I'm not taking any chances while we're sitting in the middle of this asteroid minefield. Whoever's responsible won't be able to have the droids rescue him after I lock him up. Nothing will cut through that door. He'll be trapped.
This guy seems convinced that Korda was responsible. This isn't the first time I've heard problems about Korda.
I secured the stealth field generator inside one of the footlockers in the security storage room. If I have the specs right, the interface field should be effective against the droid sensors. All I need to do is equip the belt and some skill with stealth in order to use it. As long as I don't get too close to the droids, they shouldn't detect me. If any more droids start malfunctioning, the belt should buy me enough time to get to the override switch I set up in the communications blister console. I'd rather shut them down than destroy them. I want to find out how these droids are being sabotaged. Maybe even turn them against whoever's sabotaging them.
Sounds like this guy was kind of clever. There's somebody still alive in that holding cell. Maybe I can get some answers.
So in this game, you can break items now by bashing open crates and stuff. Originally, you couldn't.
There is much energy in the room beyond, yet it stems from nothing that lives.
Kreia?
What? Can you not sense them? Reach out. Cast aside your sight. Cast aside what you see and instead reach out with your perceptions.
Huh?
Ah, you can feel them. The droids you cannot perceive, but the small oscillations of energy, that you can feel, echoing outwards.
With Kreia's help, you have gained the passive precognition power. When this power is triggered, you should save your game. Basically, any time you get a short vision of a group of assholes standing in a corridor with a weapon, probably shouldn't, you know, not save.
Ah, you hear it. It is faint, but it is there.
What? I feel strange. Like the sedatives are wearing off.
It is the force you feel. It has not been so long as for you to forget.
But it doesn't feel like it did. It feels like it's coming back from a great distance.
Do not turn away from it. Listen. Feel it echoing within you. Come. I shall guide you down.
Save you,
rock
and roll, or you die. I am one of those better safe than sorry people. Sorry, man. It's going to be one of those playthroughs. Gaining experience will slowly reestablish your connection to the Force. Go to a level-up screen in order to choose your Force abilities. Force Sensitive and Unarmed Specialist 1. Force Speed, one of the most overpowered skills in the entirety of Star Wars KOTOR. Now we can use our limited security expertise to open up some of these low security foot lockers. And we also found a stealth field generator, so now we can stealth if we want. Chances are we're not going to, because stealth isn't really that important in this game. I'd argue it was even less important than its predecessor. Yeah, that kind of is what stealth does, really, because sneaking past enemies doesn't get you experience points in this game. I feel that's something I should note for anybody who's never played it before that watches this. So there's really no reason to ever stealth unless you just don't need experience, which for 95% of the game, you absolutely will need the experience points. So I don't know why you wouldn't try to make sure to get as much as possible. Oh, damn! I actually hit him with both shots. I hear a mining droid. Get a med pack. Did I hide the shit out of that guy? With a rapid shot, too. That was what got me. I didn't think I was gonna hit him both times. I'm actually kind of impressed by that. Not gonna lie. Alright, so we gotta clear out all the mining droids on the level in order to be able to actually access that console and deactivate the force field. Yep, can't open that. I decided to go with a build that has an emphasis on blasters to start, so that until I get a hold of a lightsaber, I will be shooting things to show off some blaster combat more efficiently, since last playthrough was entirely a melee playthrough. Super aim. More components. Just double checking to see if there's anywhere else I need to go. Oh wait, is that the emergency hatch? Yeah, that's the emergency hatch. You can't get through there yet. That hatch is basically going to remain sealed until we're pretty much out of here.
Emergency lockdown is in effect. Turbo lifts happen.
All right, can we access the blister console now? There we go. Override switch shut down the security field on the prison cells, which is good.
Beyond this door, someone yet lives. Be mindful. His thoughts are difficult to read. But you have nothing to fear from this one. And he might yet prove useful.
All right.
Nice outfit. What, you miners change regulation uniform while I've been in here?
Sorry about that. Had to fix my back. You got a name or just a big mouth?
Atten. Atten Rand. Excuse me if I don't shake hands. The field only causes mild electrical burns.
Care to explain why you're locked up?
Security claimed I violated some trumped-up regulation or another. Take it up with them if you want. But they stopped listening to me shortly before they stopped feeding me. Now that's criminal.
What is this place?
You mean you didn't come here on purpose? I'm shocked. I really am. This slice of paradise is the Peragus mining facility, the only supplier of shipping-grade engine fuel to this corner of the galaxy. Peragus fuel plays havoc with engines, but it gets the job done. As long as you don't mind the toxic byproducts and trying to mine it without blowing yourself up.
Blowing yourself up?
Yeah, this asteroid belt is one giant minefield. One proton torpedo, even a stray blaster shot, can start an explosion that'll make the one that shattered Peragus 2 look like a kid's pop detonator.
Peragus 2?
You know the planet with the exposed core you saw flying in? That hole was caused by the first mining station that tried to siphon fuel off the planet. Blew a whole chunk out of the planet and set it drifting out here in a big clump of fuel-cooled asteroids. So the miners drill the asteroids now, not the planet's surface. That's why they don't allow blasters here. Can't trust a miner jumped up on Juma juice not to fire one stray shot that'll turn the entire colony into a thermal detonator.
This facility is deserted. What happened here?
You mean before or after that Jedi showed up? Either way, it's a real short story. You see, this Jedi shows up, and you know what that means. Where there's one Jedi, the Republic will soon be crawling up your ion engine in no time. But the story gets better. See, some of the miners get it into their ferrocrete skulls that since the Jedi's unconscious, they can collect the bounty the exchange has posted for live Jedi. Well, what passes for the law here didn't like that idea. So the two groups started fighting.
Then there was some big explosion, and then I was sitting here for a long time, waiting for some half-naked miner to show up and ask a bunch of questions.
There's a bounty on captured Jedi? Why?
Don't know much about it. Maybe the Exchange wants one as a trophy. Somebody's got something against Jedi and is looking to collect. Not many Jedi left. Wouldn't surprise me if the bounty's pretty high.
Not many left? What happened to them?
The ones that weren't killed in the Jedi Civil War ended up switching off the lightsabers long ago. Word is there's not even a Jedi Council anymore, but who knows?
I heard rumors of a war. But a war between Jedi?
Yeah, Revan, Malak, and the Jedi that went to join them in the Mandalorian Wars. They turned against the other Jedi and had a scrap that almost laid waste to the galaxy. Where have you been?
I've been away since the Mandalorian Wars.
Well, I wasn't there. But like all Sith, Revan and Malak turned on each other. After they turned on the Jedi, of course.
The rumors I heard said Revan defeated Malak. No. I was led to believe that Revan saved the Jedi and the Republic.
I guess. There's rumors all over space about it. All I heard was Revan returned to pay Malak back for trying to kill her in the first place. You know women.
How long have you been in that cage? Revan was a man, not a woman.
Maybe you're right. Maybe I just hoped Revan was a woman.
I really don't know what made him think Revan could have been female. I guess, actually, that may have actually been the developer's attempt before the expanded universe books were released and confirmed it was male, for you to decide that Revan was actually a woman, because Revan can be female if you play through a female character in the first game.
Look, no offense or anything, but your weird half-naked interrogation isn't my idea. Hey, wait a minute. You're that Jedi the miners were talking about. Where is everybody?
I don't know. This facility seems abandoned.
The miners can't all be gone. But if they are... Look, hey, let me out and I can help you. I can. I've gotten out of trouble countless times.
Tell me your plan and we can go from there.
This facility isn't a military installation, which means we may have a chance. You shut down the cell security field and I can reroute the emergency system so we can get to the hangars. We grab a ship and then we fly out of here.
One thing first. The patients in the medical bay were killed with a lethal dose of sedatives. Know anything about that?
Huh? What are you talking about?
Wanted to know if you knew anything, and you
so
don't.
So you done interrogating me, or are we going to work together and try to get out of this mess?
Calm down. All right. I'll switch off the cage, but if you try and run on. All right.
Great. Now to business. Let's get to the command console.
All right. Let's go.
All right. Here we are. Now this console is set on automatic hail. You may have heard it when you came in. The asteroid drift charts are constantly being updated. So it sends out a transmission to incoming vessels so they don't get crushed into space dust. The hail warns them to keep their distance until orbital drift charts are transmitted, and then provides docking instructions to incoming ships, usually freighters. Thing is, you can bounce that same transmission back to the comm here, and suddenly you've got access to the communication system from the inside. Pure pizzack. The console's ours. Now, all we need to do is reactivate the turbo lifts, cancel the emergency lockdown, and hey!
Sounds like you're about to tell me something I don't want to hear.
This system's been severed from the main hub, after it was locked down from remote. You can't even reroute the system, it's been cut clean.
That wouldn't be standard procedure in an emergency lockdown.
No. Someone tried to lock down this whole level tight, and leave us here. Trapped.
Is there anything else we can do with this console?
All we have is communications back. For all the good trying to shout in a vacuum will do us.
Can we contact the miners?
We could try. But if the miners were trying to trap you up here and probably kill you, why not call them and chat? I don't think a friendly call is going to wake them up.
Let's see if we can try and reach someone on comm.
Be my guest. Not much else we can do. The comm's all yours.
You read me down there. Huh? Do a diagnostic and then follow my instructions. I need another route off this level. Now. Is there any other way out of here besides the turbo lifts? I'd rather risk it than be trapped up here.
So T3M4 from the Prologue is still available. He is equipped with a mining laser and his droid shock arm. Give him the marked one droid armor we found and get him his attack modifier and awareness booster. He's also got an optimized interface, so now he's got bonuses to computer use. This will allow us to tell his skill ranks. So he's got pretty good. Okay, that's not bad. His awareness is okay. His repair isn't bad. His security is actually very nice. He's got good security. What I like about this game is it'll tell you if there's nothing or something, or like, you know, if something's empty. You'll need to blast this door open with explosives. I don't have it. I could use the mining laser, but the droid shock arm that he's carrying, believe it or not, actually a lot better than a standard blaster. So, I laughed a little bit on the inside when the game's medical log said that the carbon scoring on the Ebonhawk suggests it was in a fight. Carbon scoring, woman, there was an entire chunk of the ship blown off. And there was a proton missile stuck on the outside of the hull. Do not tell me that the carbon scoring is what showed you that. I could fix the missing parts right now, but I don't actually want to. Ah. I'm gonna get the same answer from this too, aren't I? Yeah. See, the thing about that droid shock arm is that it has infinite uses and it basically doesn't miss.
The Peragus Fuel Depot.
Components! We have components! I don't know why, I just wanted to make a Palpatine joke of Palpatine sounding panic. That shock arm has some serious fucking range, man. Ooh, sonic mines. Purged the fuel mines and found 3 sonic charges attached inside. I checked the work logs, but only droids have been in the area. I tried to contact security as soon as I found the explosives, but I can't seem to get a signal through. I've removed the remote detonators, and I'll keep the explosives on me until I can put them in a secure hold in the hangar. Or, you know, you'll die and never be able to do that. So what that droid had on him that the game is noting for you... By the way, we now have another motion tracker. It's this Ion Blast Mark 1 and the Ion Strikers. So what these are is these are anti-droid weapons that have limited uses that this droid can make heavy use of. Energy shields. Ooh. When I say you can fuck up a droid with it, that's what I mean. One shot kills the shield. The next shot kills the droid. Yeah, 3CFD won't be coming to help us for the rest of the game. Hey, look, we got a flamethrower. We can at least give him a Viking send-off. I'm a bad person. The Jedi are taking over! Like, he sounded so ridiculous in that scene. Alright, let's fix this. Functionality restored. Yay!
From the Jedi's freighter is being stored in the secure cargo hold until we can pass it through the quarantine checks. And as requested, all the programming spikes the security officers wanted confiscated have been stored there as well to prevent further system compromises. The secure cargo hold should be safe enough. If anybody wants to break into it, they'd have to blow it open with explosives. Who ordered the mining droids to repair that Jedi's freighter? I come in here off the work shift, and three of them are repairing the port stabilizers? Did I miss something? Is somebody planning a trip? Because orders were that the hangar was to be locked down ever since that Jedi arrived. I don't know what maintenance is up to, but you can't just commission droids for repairs, especially with half the work shifts in medbay. Those droids are needed to repair the ventilation tunnels before gas builds up to terminal levels. It's not like that ship can go anywhere anyway. Even if it had the asteroid orbital drift charts, the Nava computer's been voice locked. You'd need the access code to get it spaceworthy. Considering this latest droid commission breach, I'm putting the droids in this section under the control of the current dock officer. If anyone sends commands to the mining droids outside this terminal, I'll be forced to enact full override. Looks like those droids got the vessel working again, even with all the damage it had taken. The maintenance officer still won't admit ordering them to fix it, though. Regardless, still no luck accessing.
It's because he's not the one who ordered it to be fixed to begin with, idiot.
Maybe by one of the corpses we found on the ship, like the old woman. If so, that ship isn't going anywhere, unless we rip out the navicomputer and put in a new one, if we even had one to spare. The only reason someone would lock their navicomputer is to hide their astrogation charts. Someone didn't want us to know where that ship was going, or where it had been. Only smugglers do that. Or someone with something to hide. That Jedi's got a lot of questions to answer.
Yeah, well, too bad you're all dead, so I can't answer those questions, ain't it? I overrode it and it still wouldn't do anything. Yeah, this thing is basically a limited number of free licenses to instantly kill droids. Free experience points, everyone! Mostly. That thing will run out of uses eventually. It's not really the most important thing to have it anyway. It's useful against certain droids, but there's literally a, there's a force power that all your force-sensitive characters can get that completely blows that ability, or that weapon, out of the water. And I will be getting it, because it invalidates a lot of fights. Someone sliced into the fuel depot's computers and created a phantom fuel leak, sealing off the area. Interesting. Somebody shot me!
So is that stupid droid of yours gonna come through or not?
It's not my droid. I don't know who he belongs to.
Well, I'm beginning to think I was a little better off in my... Hey, what do you know? A little cargo cylinder came through.
Looks like it. But it's strange he didn't contact us on the comm.
If he got the turbo lifts working, then we should have a clear run to the hangar.
The turbo lifts are locked down manually, so I had him open the emergency hatch.
Wait. Don't tell me you're taking that hatch down into the mining tunnels. Are you? That explosion I heard came from below. There's probably nothing down there except superheated rock and collapsed blast tunnels. You'd be an idiot to go down there.
Maybe, but it's the only way out. And it's better I risk my life than yours, I guess.
You're either really brave or really crazy, or both.
All right, I'll try to monitor things from up here. Be careful. The only thing moving down there is likely to be mining droids, so don't be playing hero too hard. Not that I care what happens to you or anything. I just don't want to be trying to get off this rock by myself.
Got it. Your concern is noted. I'll
keep the comm link open. I may be able to guide you through the tunnels from up here. Don't know if the signal will hold if you get too deep, though.
Roger. Oh, that's a blast door.
I forgot there was a blast door over there. Peragus Mining Station is kind of a really eerie first level to this game. Everyone's dead. Everything's either trying to kill you or malfunctioning or broken. You get talked to by a creepy old woman that was in a morgue, so everybody thought she was dead. Barely. There's a lot of static.
Down there, probably caused by that explosion. Still, it looks like there's a route down to the Peragus fuel depot. If the passages haven't collapsed, that explosion knocked out most of the sensors. There should be an emergency crate in the next room. Watch yourself. There's a lot of droid broadcasts in that area, but I can't pin them down.
I'll be careful. If you detect anything, signal me.
Will do. And be careful down there.
Hey, a miner uniform and some survey gear and a safety harness. Let me just help myself to some of that, to some clothing, and to the safety harness.
Find the emergency supplies?
Yeah, looks like there's some clothes in here.
About time. The whole half-naked Jedi thing was wearing a little thin. But there may be some survey gear and a safety harness inside the crate, too. The miners wear them when staking claims on the asteroids. The survey gear is designed to spot and protect you against sonic mines. And the safety harness can be helpful if you try to disarm them.
There's some kind of mining energy shield in this crate, too.
Yeah, it's like a military-issue energy shield, except it's designed to protect the miners against lasers and heat. Should work against the droid mining lasers. It won't last forever, and certainly not against multiple laser hits. But it may buy you some time if you get ambushed by a battalion of droids.
Got it. Let's go.
Just one more thing. I've narrowed down some of the ID signals, and if the numbers are right, you're sharing those tunnels with a battalion of mining droids.
Any advice on taking out these droids?
Destruction models. They shoot like a moisture farmer militia. Since they rely on ranged weapons, get in close with a melee weapon and start bashing them. In close combat, the guy with the vibroblade has the edge over the guy with the rifle, droid or not. Otherwise, just drill them from a distance. If they're not shielded, that is.
Shielded?
Yeah, it's possible some of the droid models may have mining shields on. If so, the shields may absorb laser fire. You can usually tell when a shield is active. It'll make an electrical field around the target. If they activate a shield, the best thing you can do is hit them with a melee weapon or try to burn out the shield with continual fire. But that could take a while, and it leaves you a target.
I'll do that. Anything else?
There's gotta be some central controller down there. See if you can find a terminal by the main access shaft. That'd be governing intelligence.
Interesting. Components and parts. Useful. I need more repair parts if I'm going to fix it.
Watch where you step. I'm picking up a lot of sonic mines down there. Don't run unless you have to. It makes them harder to spot. If you have any skill with demolitions, you might be able to recover them and use them against the droids. That is, if the mines don't get you first. If you have survey gear or a safety harness, put them on. They'll make spotting and disarming the sonic charges a little easier.
Why are there so many charges down here?
Charges after they went rogue, then they may have set them to try and kill the miners. And you. If you see one of those excavators, watch out. They may use their undeployed charges as projectiles.
Understood. Leon out. Nice game. Whatever, that barely hurt me. Oh, wow! You angy. Alright, he's gonna go on a killing spree. He is officially good mining boy. I don't know how I saw that thing through a wall, but apparently I did. He's over here like, well, human, what did I do good? Did I do good, human? That ion detonator, or that ion grenade took out so many of these guys. That grenade miss. Basic Rylith power cell. I feel like that grenade still should have hit him. Oh, hell no. Let's do 4 score up. Wow, that guy had a lot of shit on him, didn't he? An advanced mining laser. It's harder than the standard mining pistol we picked up. Man, the game really wants you to reuse some energy shields. Thank you. There we go. So these little maintenance droids, you'll notice you can kind of pop them like little balloons with how easy they are to kill. You'll always want to target them first because they will heal other mining droids. There aren't just mining droids down here. There are sensor balls, too.
Sensor? It must be maintenance drones. Watch out. Those little pests will try to repair the mining droids if you don't gun them down first. Still, it's odd they're still active after the explosion. They don't have the same shielding as the mining droids. Be careful of those droids. I don't like this.
I love how you just have, like, a million opportunities to tell him to shut the fuck up.
Hey, kid, you want to see a dead body?
Ah! That was a crit! Just immediately snipe an enemy with a frickin' advanced mining laser. Ah! Oops, I don't know what's going on with my controls there for a second. How many security spikes do I have? Oh, I don't have any! Okay. Does this computer plasteel cylinder have any more? No? Damn it! Fine, I'll shoot all the droids the hard way. There it goes. I had to kill a lot of droids, Jimmy. There are all these crazy droids. I don't know why they're jerks, but they are. So I'm shooting them. If you're wondering, this game is actually gonna make you wait, I would argue, longer than, KOTOR 1 does to get your lightsaber. Damn! tried to burn me alive with a fucking flamethrower. What a dick. I know he's a droid, so he doesn't technically have emotions, but what a dick. Ooh! One volley, ladies and gentlemen, one volley. Here, catch this with your face. Oh, wow. Yeah, so on weird random occasions, the game does this where it just kind of seems to skip through certain dialogue. I don't know why this happens. I can't seem to figure out how to get this glitch to never happen.
I'm locking down the turbo lift to the administration section now to keep the blast from spreading. If you've got anything left to do down there, make it quick, because where you are is going to get real hot, real soon.
I love that. Just hop. He fucking exploded. I'm just doing that to get the mines out of the way. You also get plenty of med packs in this game. Unless you're an idiot. It's very easy to burn through them all, but you usually have to be pretty stupid. Sonic charge. I need a sonic charge, though, in order to do that now. Shit. That was too close. Dead miner.
Greeting. It is a pleasure to see you alive, Master. Provided my receptors are not off focus. How may I be of assistance?
How do you know me? I'm not your master.
I am a survivor of the Harbinger, just as you were, Master. With the unexpected termination of my previous master, you are the only organic which I may now serve.
Who was your previous master?
Answer, the captain of the Harbinger, Master. I was in transit to Telos to facilitate communications and terminate hostilities. However, we did not arrive at our intended destination.
What happened?
Irritated answer. Oh, Master, it is such a long, dull story, and not terribly relevant to our current situation.
Why don't you tell me anyway?
Hesitant explanation. That has been the subject of considerable discussion since our arrival here, Master. Many have attempted to claim you and this unit as salvage. I was crudely interrogated concerning our brief history together on board the Harbinger, before its communications, weapons, and engines suffered the cascade failure that disabled the ship.
How come I don't remember any of this?
Speculation. It is possible you were incapacitated and locked in the well-shielded cargo compartment as the Harbinger was being systematically crippled, Master.
Incapacitated?
Clarification. Yes, Master. No doubt the flurry of destruction on board the Harbinger somehow drugged you into a stupor from which you could not awaken. Most curious.
Drugged? What do you mean, drugged?
Implication. Merely a turn of phrase, Master. The implication that your state was due to the result of ingesting large quantities of Juma juice was unintentional. I meant to communicate only that you were somehow rendered unconscious before you were locked securely in the cargo hold.
You are not a very good liar.
Clarification, by locked, I meant sealed, Master. My vocabulator seems to be malfunctioning.
Okay, so I'm not gonna spoil it, but you should already have figured out what's wrong with this guy.
Recitation. Following the unusual set of coincidences that led to the cascade failure in the Harbinger's systems, we were boarded by a small freighter with unknown ID codes. It appeared that this freighter had been attacked, and the captain wanted to study it. This freighter appeared to be still spaceworthy. Your cargo compartment was breached, and you were taken on board the freighter shortly before the Harbinger's systems began to go critical. I, too, managed to board the freighter before the Harbinger's destruction. We were most fortunate to have survived, Master.
Any idea what had attacked that small freighter?
Evaluation. Master, I do not know. Judging from the damage, it had been attacked by a much larger vessel. And when it attempted to escape the Harbinger with you on board, it was fired on again. Addendum. It does seem odd that such a small vessel has a high probability of attracting the attention of much larger vessels. Not a welcome trait in a freighter, to be sure.
Why was this freighter that the Harbinger brought on? What was this freighter the Harbinger brought on board?
I believe it was a smuggler's vessel by the name of the Ebon Hawk. Speculation. As to its purpose, I do not know. Perhaps it was always its intention to play dead, then kidnap you off the Harbinger and rob me of my bounty.
That should be the last clue you need to know what this thing is and to know that it is not a fucking protocol droid, which is what it's trying to tell you it is.
Clarification. By bounty, I refer to your life, Master. It would pain me to see you damaged in any way. That is why the arrival of this Ebon Hawk caused me considerable distress.
But why would that ship have taken me off the Harbinger?
Apology. My memory core cannot provide a clear answer on that point, Master. Suffice to say that once we arrived at this floating rock, our situation became much clearer.
That's a lie.
Explanation. Despite my market value, Master, the miners were far more interested in you. It did not take long for me to ascertain the reason for this. While an HK protocol droid is a valuable piece of property, Jedi are worth much more in certain exclusive markets across the galaxy. Painful admission. I must confess to feelings of inferiority at the speculated difference between my value and the price for your capture. I was forced to remind myself it was not due to a failing of my model or function, but because you were a Jedi.
I'm sorry. I'm laughing hysterically because when I was a kid, I never picked up on what the fuck was wrong with this droid. But now that I'm older and a little smarter, I'm reading this dialogue. I'm listening to the way he's talking. Jesus Christ, it's obvious that this guy is not a fucking protocol droid.
Surprised answer. Why, I told them, Master. You are the exiled Jedi who served with Revan in the Mandalorian Wars, are you not? I hope all that has happened has not been the result of a miscommunication. If so, then the problem lies with the core word databases, which are notoriously spotty. Answer, all that has happened has been because they believe you to be a Jedi Master. They debated what to do with you as you lay unconscious in the medical bay. One group seemed intent on selling you as property. The other group opposed this. 3 standard hours after the division between the miners became apparent, accidents began to occur throughout the facility. A result of improper maintenance, I believe. These accidents coincided with the degradation of the mining droid behavioral cores. Crude models are prone to such failures, resulting in murderous rampages. The mortality rate of organics in the facility rose quickly.
I'm just gonna say it now. It should be completely stone-headed obvious by this point. Protocol droids do not talk like that.
Many miners began to join you in the medical bay as a cascade of flawlessly timed detonations occurred in isolated gas pockets in the lower levels of the facility. The explosions herded the miners into emergency sections of the station quickly and efficiently, cutting them off from communications and facility control. But sadly enough, not the ventilation systems.
Sadly enough? What do you mean?
You see, the explosions had damaged specific sections of this facility's ventilation systems, causing a slow, lethal buildup of toxic fumes in the dormitory level.
Are you responsible for all this?
Defensive answer. Master, I am a protocol droid.
No, you're not!
An assassination droid of unrivaled sophistication. Would have required an unusual set of skills. It is highly unlikely I possess the knowledge to have a reproduction of space worker class droids into killing machines, let alone to terminate the organics of this facility, utilizing only Aerotech 500 series laser mining drills and explosives fashioned from proton missile cores.
I feel like you are responsible.
I cannot and will not attempt to change your mind, Master. I would urge you to consider that your auto-tank treatments may have caused some disorientation.
Oh my God, I love this so much. His dialogue is so fucking stupid. The Obsidian Entertainment had a hell of a sense of humor. Jesus Christ. Do you know who administered the sedatives to the Colto tanks in the medical bay, which killed the incapacitated miners?
Conjecture. The administration of a large dose of sedatives over a short period of time would likely prove fatal to miners, although not to a Jedi.
Why do you know that?
It would simply render them unconscious for ease of transport. Quite inventive.
Again... why do you know that? If you're a protocol droid, why do you know that?
Answer. I was merely commenting on the idea itself, Master, not the execution of the idea. Though that, too, was inventive. Besides, Master, those miners intended to murder you, or worse. Any complaints they would have at being murdered would be the highest form of hypocrisy.
Okay. So, he kind of spoiled it right there himself. That's not a protocol droid, that's an HK assassin droid. And no, that's not HK-47. Unfortunately, that's not the fun HK. That's the stupid HK, as we'll come to tell. Or one of many stupid HKs, because those assholes are on a fucking production line. Oh my god, that's so funny. Jesus Christ, that was so funny. He doesn't even try to hide it, really. He really doesn't try to hide it from you. Oh my god, I'm not an elite assassin droid with so many skills. Yes, you fucking are. That was an oddly specific answer for a protocol droid. Fuck it. Grenades are incredibly useful early game, although they fall off later. Damn! I'm so sorry to everyone watching that. I just could not control it. Next time I will try to mute my mic. I totally forgot to do that. While I kill myself through laughter. Jesus Christ. His dialogue is so stupid. Like, this assassin droid can do everything except actually convince them that he's not an assassin droid. He's so bad. My god. Oh, Jesus, that killed me. He's so stupid for a droid that is supposed to be modeled after HK-47. I don't have words for how dumb what I did. Damn! Okay. I didn't think that was going to happen. I don't have words for how stupid that was. I'm sorry. I'm so sorry to everybody who had to watch that. That was so funny. His fucking dialogue is so bad. Oh. That had to be one of the most hilarious things I've ever heard in my life. Add stun droid. You can fail it. So, stun droid doesn't just stun a droid, as you may have already noticed. It also damages it. Thank you. And that's the value of stun droid. Obviously, we don't have much force power right now, but that'll change. So, mines! Alright, unfortunately that's all we have time for, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all very much for watching. I've been Savage Hound Dusk. Please, if you want to see all my previous streams, head over to YouTube, look for Alpha Wolf, you should find me. And all my previous streams will be there. Have a great day. Ugh.